Kalman filter can be described by a set of mathematical recursions. But how do you apply these in practice? Well, the purpose of this lecture is to provide three examples, automotive examples, that actually have some quite important and nice take-home messages. So I will describe how to estimate the yaw rate in a car, the leaning angle of a motorcycle, and how to characterize a speed hump when you pass it. Let's start with the virtual yaw rate sensor. So we derived in another lecture a virtual yaw rate sensor based on wheel speeds. So if you can measure the wheel speeds on one axis, then you can compare them and both determine the speed of the car and the yaw rate. And if you have a gyroscope on your car, you can also directly measure the yaw rate, but that gyroscope will have a bias, and that bias will give rise to a drift in your yaw angle that might become quite cumbersome after a while. So the core idea here is to combine these two gyro information sources in a Kalman filter and see if we can eliminate some of the drift over time. So the wheel speed virtual yaw rate sensor is not drift-free either, because you don't have exactly the same wheel radius. And this little relative difference in wheel radius will turn up in the virtual yaw rate sensor. So if you look at this from a Kalman filter perspective, we need to determine what to include in the state vector. And from these three measurements, we need at least to have the yaw angle, the yaw rate, the bias of the gyroscope, and this ratio between the wheel radius. We can also note that we denoted the car speed here with UK, indicating that we consider this to be an input to the Kalman filter. More on this later on. So we've seen automatic motors before, and the simplest discrete time formulation is that we sum up the yaw rate, multiply the sampling time, add that to the previous yaw angle to get the new yaw angle. And our new position in x and y coordinates, so for instance the x coordinate, is the sum of the previous x coordinate plus the speed times the sampling interval, multiplied with cosine of the yaw angle, and similarly for the y coordinate. So we need to include also x and y in the state vector. We might have a speed v here as a state. In that case, the wheel speeds will provide another measurement to the Kalman filter. But in many aspects, it's more convenient to consider the speed to be an input to the state space model. And that way, we can have less states in the state vector, which is usually to prefer. Because we have two different, since we have two different measurements of yaw rate, we cannot consider psi dot here as an input. There is no way to include information from two different measurements as one input to the model. So that is why you consider psi dot to be a measurement and a state. So combining these, we have a complete discrete time state space model suitable for the extended Kalman filter. So the combined state vector includes position, yaw angle, yaw rate, the bias of the gyroscope, and the bias, so to call it, from the wheel radius, which is denoted by the ratio of the unknown wheel radius. So we have five states, we have two measurements, we have one input. We need to assign noise properties to all of them. So you note that the input has a noise term called W, so we consider this to be process noise because it enters into the state equations in the time update here. Another thing to note is how to include this virtual measurement here of psi dot. So the most convenient way is to consider the measurement to be zero all the time, and that zero should be the real yaw rate minus what we compute from the wheel speeds plus some noise. Observability is very important to determine for a given problem. The key question is, does the information we get from the measurement suffice to compute the state vector? You can determine that in a formal way by computing the observability matrix. So we need to linearize the model in a suitable working point and then compute the observability matrix and check if it has full rank. In this case, we can look at the equation and saying that we need the car to turn. Why is that? Let's go back and check here. We see that the bias is constant in a gyroscope, while the delta term here is multiplied by omega 3 over omega 4. So if the omega 3 over omega 4 is constant all the time, then delta will also in the end be constant over time, and we cannot distinguish this offset from this offset. And conversely, if omega 3 over omega 4 changes, then we will get linearly independent combinations of these delta and the b, and we can actually distinguish these two when they are observable. It requires some deep calculations maybe, but that's the intuition I have for it. So the result is that the model is observable if and only if the car changes yaw rate, so omega 3 over omega 4 changes over time. You can do the formal analysis computing the observability matrix and you will find the same condition. The important thing is that it works in practice, and that's your trial and error approach to it. Just apply the Kalman filter and see if it works and if the covariance seems to decrease over time. So we have done some tests in Vallarundellen. So what you see here is a test drive in Vallarundellen. So we will see two different curves here. The red one is the odometric model, where we do not use the virtual yaw rate sensor computed from the wheel speeds. And the blue one is the odometric model, where we use the virtual yaw rate sensor. And in that way, we can eliminate the drift in the gyro. So the red curve will suffer from this drift in the yaw angle, while the blue one can compensate for it. So as we will see in the second lap here, the blue line overlaps the previous lap. So it seems to have quite a high accuracy, and the position fits the overlaid map also quite well. And also on the third lap, we get a nice overlap, while the red one is a bit off and certainly behind because of drift in the gyroscope. And as a final check, we will leave the roundabout at the same place as we entered, and then we can see that the total error in yaw angle is very small. Let's proceed to the next application. It's about estimating the leaning angle of a motorcycle. So why do you need the leaning angle? Well, one application is to steer the headlight, so it always points down on the road in front of you, not out in the forest. Another one is for supporting the ABS and anti-spin systems, because if the motorcycle is leaning, the traction forces cannot be that large, and you have to be more conservative in your control actions. So when we did this study, it was a master thesis student who did it, the gyroscopes were quite expensive compared to accelerometers. So the hypothesis is that you can get sufficient accuracy of the leaning angle by combining accelerometers and gyroscopes. So the first thing you have to think of in such an application is, what state vector do you need? So we are interested in the leaning angle. So phi as a leaning angle, the goal angle, must be there. We probably need at least one derivative. It turns out that also the second derivative is nice to have there. You also need the yaw rate and its derivative. And as usual, we need the bias states for the sensors. So the state dynamics is more or less straightforward. The triple integrator for roll angle, double integrator for yaw rate, and the sensor biases are just a random walk. The sensor models are more complicated. They are based on mechanical relations. And from them you get these three sensor models for AY, AZ, and phi dot. So they are all functions of the state vector and the input U here. There are also some parameters that describes the motorcycle construction, but they can be considered to be known. So then comes the fun part, to evaluate this, so to make some test drives. We need a reference sensor. That's because of we need a ground truth to compare to. So we know that the Kalman filter provides for sufficient accuracy. In offline, we can then combine running the Kalman filter with different subsets of the sensors. So we can use all sensors, all but the gyro, only one accelerometer, etc. So if you use all sensors, you get this performance. If you skip the gyro, you get this. So you can see that it's not as good, but it still satisfies the performance requirements. So that is, you can get a cost-efficient solution just using cheap accelerometers and skip the more expensive yaw-rate gyro for this application. Next example is for estimating speed bumps. So we see an example here in the picture, an artificial speed bump, and an experiment where we pass the speed bump and it measures the wheel speed. So the question is, can you actually characterize the speed bump just measuring the wheel speed, which is anyhow available in the automotive computer? Well, it is actually possible. You need a dynamic model for how the wheel speed depends on the road profile. That can be derived from mechanical equations. We can apply a Kalman's model, and the problem here is that we might get a drift, but if you assume that the road is level, so the height is the same after the hump as before, we get the constraint of a state. You can also see here what we have put markers on the car, yellow, blue, and green one, and there was a red one here, to be used as a ground truth. So we use a computer vision detector to detect these markers, and in that way we can position the wheel and the chassis along the trajectory. So what we will see in the video is these four lines that tracks the markers on the car. We have a ground truth, the red one here, which is measured by a ruler. We have the blue signal here, which is the measured wheel speed. And we take one of the state estimates from the Kalman filter, namely the estimated height of the road, and plot it and compare it to the ground truth here. And we will first make a forward sweep of the Kalman filter and notice the drift, and then make this virtual measurement that the height is the same before and after the bump, and then make a backward sweep applying the RTS smoother from the textbook. So let's look at the wheel speed here. So when you hit the bump, the speed decreases, but then you excite the dynamics of the tire and driveline, so you get this impulse response like shape here. That depends on the speed bump profile as well. Let's watch the video again and focus on the Kalman filter estimate of the height profile here. It looks a bit shaky here, and in particular it gives a big drift here in the end, so it's very hard to estimate the height of the road just from the wheel speed. But when we invoke this constraint and apply the Kalman smoother backward sweep, we see that the level of the road becomes the same, and it compensates for the drift in a very good way, so the final estimate of the speed hump is very similar to the ground truth. To sum up, do you agree now that Kalman filters can be quite funny to work with, and the applications can be quite spectacular? So what I want to highlight now is a couple of different concepts. Ground truth first. It's very important when you do measurements to plan for having a ground truth, so you can evaluate the performance and say something quantitatively and qualitatively about the performance. Next one is observability. So you can immediately, before you do any experiments, judge if the problem is realistic with the given measurements. Virtual measurements. We have seen two kinds of virtual measurements. One when you combine wheel speeds to compute a virtual yaw rate, and another kind based on a constraint, a state constraint. We also saw the input or output ambiguity that shows up in some applications. So any measured quantity can in some cases be used both as an input, U, or as an output, Y, in the Kalman filter framework. Smoothing. So do you get important information in the end, like the constraint for the speed bump? Well, in that case, you might get much better estimates if you apply this backward sweep of the RTS smoother. And this one particular application, deriving cost-effective solutions in applications, where you have a selection of different sensors. Some are very expensive, some are cheap, but there might be combinations of cheap sensors that can replace an expensive sensor, so you get a cost-effective solution. Reading advice for this part is section 16.2.